So we are the Content Tools team of Fundamental Research Group Collaborative Communities Portal. So I'm Naveen, this is Danush, Adarsh and Saurabh. So the main aim of this Collaborative Communities Portal is to encourage the users to come forward from all over the world and update their contents and share their knowledge. And that shared knowledge should be reached among, like it should be reachable to many users. So for such platform, it should be, it is necessary that the users should be provided with tools which extend their reach. It is also necessary that the contents created by the user should be validated. It should not be inappropriate because it's targeted to a wider audience. So we should have some tool which can detect the inappropriateness of the content creator. So in this internship period, we created four modules. We integrated four modules with the collaborative community. And one of them, real-time collaborative editor and inappropriate content filter and wiki page for each community and integration of new content type, H5P. Then these are the technologies used by us. Django is the basic web framework which collaborative community is built on. And the wiki page integrated with this Django is Django Wiki. And Etherpad, Node, and Socket.io, we use this for integrating real-time collaborative editor. And H5PP is the port for H5P in Python. And PyTorch, Pandas, Glow, NumPy, and Bcalls, we have used it for inappropriate content filter. Now we will be explaining on each of the modules. So I'll hand over this to Adarsh.
So this is real-time collaborative editor. Now basically, what is a collaborative editor? Over here, like this is just like a normal text editor, but additional feature is that not only one user, but more than one user can edit the document simultaneously, and at the same time, they can see the others' changes that they are making. So the two main examples that we see here are Google Docs and ShareLatex. They are real-time collaborative editor. Now, why do we need it in our system? Actually, in collaboration system, when a community article is created, it passes through four stages. That is draft, visible state, publishable, and published state. Now, when the article is in visible state, it is open for editing by all the users. So there we need a platform where the users can edit the document simultaneously. Here, collaborative editor comes into play. The collaborative editor that we chose was Etherpad, mainly because of these features. First of all, it is real time, that it should be. Next, it is scalable to thousands of simultaneous real-time users. It also allows us to export the document as HTML or PDF. Moreover, it has many plugins available that enhances its features. And last and the most important is it is based on operational transform and change sets. So how did we implement Etherpad? Basically, what happens is this Etherpad instance, it runs on the Node server. And in the Django server, which contains the main system, an instance of the Etherpad is run using an iframe. Now, the communication, real-time communication, happens through Socket.io. And the database that is used is common for both Node server and the Django server. To make things more clear, this is a workflow diagram. As you can see, this is the Node server. This Node server runs the Etherpad instance on port 9001. Now, this server helps in the article creation and editing. For the article creation and editing, the store table of the collaboration database keeps all the required content in the form of change sets. These change sets, they are very important regarding Etherpad. Now, when the user has to view the article, he uses the basic article table because here the article is not kept in the form of change sets, but in a HTML format so that user can easily read it. And this store table and the basic article table, they are synced after every 3 seconds so that the user can be updated with the view. And this, you can see the real-time thing happens through Socket.io. That's it by my side. Next is interactive content. Saurabh will explain it.
A very good evening to one and all. I'll be explaining the second module that we have implemented, that is interactive content. Now you would be wondering, what is the need of integrating such a thing? The current system provided to us rendered only basic article and course creation. And as you all know, in this digital era, we are in a stage that we need interactive learning, and that there comes the need of interactive content. And as you know, for any project, the aim has always been to expand, enhance, and extend the system. This where we come into the pro role. And now, what is H5P? H5P stands for HTML5 package, which gives us the option of creating interactive content. And in the current situation, the official plugins are only available for WordPress, Drupal, and Moodle. And this package facilitates us the creation of interactive videos, interactive presentations, and a whole lot of other H5P interactive contents. There are some examples. This is one of the course presentation that I was creating on the official website, h5p.org. This is another one, interactive video. And now, our approach of integrating this in the collaborative communities portal. As you know, the collaborative communities portal is a Django project, and there is no official support for creation of H5P contents on Django. So after a long search, we found out a open source plugin that is H5PP, HTML5 package for Python. It is available for Django, but it is currently in beta stage. So this is the link of the GitHub repository that we were using. As you can see, this is a workflow diagram. Whenever a user interacts with a collaborative community portal and he has to create an interactive content, he will be redirected to the H5P server where he can create or upload H5P content. After the creation, when he clicks on save, he'll be redirected to the collaborative community server where he'll be shown the list of community or group content. And then there, he can click on the, like, view the interactive content, and then he'll be redirected again to the H5P server. This is, as you can see, these are some of the screenshots of our integration. As you can see, this create resource option provides us with interactive content. When you click on this, you'll be redirected to the H5P server where you can create or upload H5P contents. When you click on save, you'll be redirected to this content list. These are the group of community contents. It includes articles as well as courses. So whenever you click on any interactive content, then you will be redirected again to the H5P server where you will be able to view it. So that's it from my side. Now we'll be explaining the third module, and that is Wiki, and it will be explained by Naveen.
So in the previous system, for the description of a community, we had only like a single paragraph where the community admin would be editing for at the first, like at the time of creation of a community, you'll be just editing and what this community is all about. But as the time goes on, the communities, they will have a vision and they will have some objectives which they have to follow for the better future of the community. So such content, such overview of the community should be listed properly in a more structured manner. So that will reach, like if a new user comes to the, like wants to join the community, you should get the whole overview of the community. So that's where this wiki page for the community comes in. So we have integrated Django Wiki for this content, which had permission system, like who can edit the article and who can view it and stuff, and revision control, like after each edit, it will be saved each revision, and you can add images, files, and whatever you want. It's like a normal wiki page. So the structure of Django Wiki is like this. The main reason for choosing Django Wiki is one, because of its structure. Root Wiki will be there, which will have the information of the whole collaborative communities portal. And under that, each community will have its own wiki page, and each group under each community will be having separate wiki page. So this is a screenshot of wiki page of one of the communities. So now Danush will explain inappropriate content filter.
As said in the introduction, like collaborative communities is open for large range of people, it is more appropriate that the content published in the community should be proper, and it should not be like harassing for the others. So in a recent survey, it was found that 39% of the experts agree that the future will be more, like on an online media, future will be more shaped by harassment and troll-like behavior. So that's the reason inappropriate content filter is a necessary tool in a huge open, like in a huge open platform like collaborative systems. So what is inappropriate content filter? Inappropriate content filter is a tool which you know, which checks the appropriateness of a piece of information for a large public audience. The inappropriate content filter that we built, like it can be broadly segregated into two parts, the encoder and the fully connected network. The encoder can again be segregated into two parts, word embedding and the LSTM network. This is how the data flow through the model. And finally, it outputs a single number, either 0 or 1. So for an overview of inappropriate content filter, first thing, it's implemented using PyTorch. Second one, we got the data set to train the model from Kaggle, and that's the link. This is the link. The data set contains a total of 159,571 records, we got an accuracy of 88.17% percentage. In collaborative communities, how we integrated it was, when a user requests for a request for save changes, the collaborative community server, the inappropriate content filter, it's actually running on a node server. The collaborative community sends a request to the node server, the inappropriate content filter will send back either 0 or 1 based on the appropriateness of the article. So the next is dockerization. Saurabh will explain.
So the current status of our code is, the following modules have been fully dockerized. The H5P module runs as a separate Docker container named H5P. Etherpad runs as a separate Docker container node. And the collaborative communities runs on a web container. And the database on DB. So these four services have been defined in the Docker Compose file inside the collaborative communities. And these are fully operational. Since Wiki was a Django Wiki framework, it has already been integrated inside the collaborative community system, and it runs inside the web container. These are the links to our code. You can surely refer it. And now coming to the conclusion and our future work. In this project, we have implemented Etherpad, which allows real-time collaborative editing of articles. Secondly, we integrated interactive content, which was facilitated using H5PP, which paves the path for user experiences towards interactive learning. Thirdly, Django Wiki app, which facilitates describing the community's objective in a structured manner, mainly a wiki page for a community. And finally, the inappropriate content filter, which prevents or flags abusive or toxic content and maintains the integrity of the system. To be noted, the system built by us has been tested using Selenium by the OER repository team. Coming to the future work, on the Etherpad, our objective as future work is auto-saving of articles should be implemented based on user activity. Okay. And secondly, implementation of H5P should be there in an iframe. Redirection to the server cost us a lot of time. And thirdly, making the inappropriate content filtered model more dynamic. And finally, building an architecture to automatically flag the article regarding its appropriateness. Also, in the wiki wiki side, we have currently the community wikis. What our future work is that we also should have group wikis. Now we'll show a demo of the collaborative editor.
So here is a demo of the collaborative editor. At this point of time, we can see that in the right window pane, a user is typing something, and correspondingly, the left pane has this the same content coming up. So basically, the thing is that the different color shows that they are being typed by two different users, and the thing is happening collaboratively. This is it.
These are the references.
Any queries if you have?
Yes, I was actually expecting you to also show how the merging of two change sets take place, actually. That would have been better.
We can go into the theory part if you wish.
Yeah, but yeah, it makes sense.
Actually, due to lack of time, we had to just cut through otherwise we had...
Sure, maybe we can take that offline. So yeah, the other question is, why do you need Wiki, actually? Because the same thing that you're doing is already, that is possible with collaborative communities as well. You can have an article for each of the each of these communities and sub-communities?
Wiki is like a description for the community. Whenever a new user, uses a collaborative communities, when he browses through communities, he doesn't have idea what the community does or what it is meant for. To get an overview of the how the community works and what its ethics and objectives, the wiki helps. In wiki, they can.
Yeah, and that is being done collaboratively, right?
No.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is collaborative. Mm.
Okay. The same thing.
But so in case of articles, we can't have different pages. But yeah, wiki can have sub pages under it and all, right? So basically, it's more structured than article. Article is a single page and just things will be. But in this case, we can attach files and images and create macros in all in this also.
Yeah, so and maybe you could also edit it, keep on editing it. Means you can have new guidelines.
It has a markdown syntax. So
right.
I think you should give some users to edit that wiki, because that those guidelines would be very important for that community or that group. Not everybody should be able to edit that wiki.
Actually, we were trying to keep up with the original concept of wiki. Wiki is lying on the concept that it should be open to one and all. It should be open for editing, but there should be someone who restricts who gets to.
There is someone who gets to check upon those edits. It should be open to one and all, because the concept is that the community will be there to.
There is a problem here. You don't have just one wiki. You have a wiki for every community or every group, right? So once the guidelines are formed or framed, so they remain for 1 year, 2 years without changing. So you don't need to edit. So you may have to block some permission.
If you understand,
responsible people can actually be allowed to edit that wiki or something.
So
now you define based on your reputation, whether the person is responsible for editing wiki or not.
Yes.
Or the first person who starts the community.
So I was just curious, so this is not technical actually. So you have actually implemented 4 different parts. So is that the case that each one of you have implemented the part which you have presented? Is that the case?
It's not
or
like
you're
that.
Done collaboratively?
Good. Basically, we worked on 2 different models. Two of us worked on HFAB and Wiki.
We worked in a pair of 2. Mm-hmm. Two people worked.
HFAB and Wiki, Saurabh and Naveen worked.
And we 2 worked on inappropriate content filter and the real-time collaborative editor.
So we started the real-time collaborative editor. Mm-hmm. Then it was taking time, so we thought 2 of us should split and work on HFAB and Wiki.
Okay.
And then at the end, inappropriate content.
Yeah, so you kept on adding as you got.
Yeah, managing.
Good.
See, your demo was good. If you have just shown the demo with the 2 people, collaboration. Have you tried with 4 people?
Yeah, we have tried with more
people. 1 on first page and second 2 group on third page.
Sorry, sir?
2 people are editing on first page and 2 people are editing on fourth page.
Yeah, it works. Article is a single page.
How the rendering does?
Happens is, once the article is I told you about the store table. So when the users are editing it, until then it is in the store table. After that, it goes into the basic article table through a use of API call. What it does is it converts the chain sets into HTML form.
Everything is happening in real time. That's where the chain sets come in. It operates along with operational transform and.
You are showing on the web page.
Yeah.
So on web page, when a person is on first page editing something.
Yeah. It's just a single page. There is no first page, second page. It's just a scrolling run, huh? Okay. Thank you.